Yeah. Folks, welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show, and here to see Cubensis, Nathaniel Lapointe. Got to speak over the traffic. Welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show, man.
All the motorcycles here in Ramona.
Tell me, what still is in your heart about Bobby Womack?
You know,
and how do you bring it to the stage?
There's a sense of community and family that is never going to go away. I mean, literally right before we went on stage, I got a message from Bobby's son that just said, "Miss you, brother." I said, "Miss you too. Let's hang soon." It was literally right before we went on for soundcheck. And you never really lose those things once you experience that with those people. And Bobby's son wasn't even in the band. He was just part of our scene and our crew. And we loved him as much as we loved anybody else. And so you carry that with you.
You saw him at Bonnaroo the last time you ever saw him alive. But can you tell a great Bobby Womack story to this? I mean, to me, what's cool is you're my generation.
Right.
But you got a chance to play with him.
Yes.
And that's what's kind of missing in modern music is the ability for the younger guys to play with the shamans.
Sure.
So can you talk about, give me a good Bobby story, especially how it relates to whatever rhythm you might have adopted from him or stole or whatever.
I mean, we talk so much about how caring and loving and giving he was to us, but it didn't come easy. You had to earn that from Bobby. And I'll tell you a story. It might have been my second or third gig, and we were outdoors at a festival sound checking before the show. And I had yet to memorize the set list, you know, sort of the outline that we'd have for the show. Obviously, we would deviate quite a bit, but I had yet to memorize that basic outline, and we were doing sound check, and we would usually do, you know, just intros and outros of every song just to make sure everything was working properly and everybody could hear each other. And so we'd get finished with one song, and Bobby, being a guitar player, you know, he had all the songs were guitar intros. And so we get to the beginning of the next song, and I realize that my set list that was right in front of me on the floor had blown away. And so they count off the tune, and I don't know which tune it is. It's a guitar intro. I'm supposed to start the damn thing, and I don't start it. And Bobby was not happy with me.
Did he berate you on stage, or no? He just booked.
Yes. Now keep in mind, it was sound check. Nobody except for crew was in the
sound check. Right on. This is
arena at that
it's
point.
Fascinating.
But still, he's on mic, and he comes over to me. And again, it's my second or third gig. I was still pretty green at that point. You know, earning my
very green, you know, man. Very green.
And so he comes up and he's on mic and he starts yelling and he starts saying, "Ah, you fuck up this set." You know, he said, "You do that tonight, I'm gonna shoot you." And he said, "Yeah, you would have done that on James Brown's stand. You would have gotten fired just now." And I was pretty scared.
I think that's just the same pep talk. I think that was the same pep talk he got from James Brown.
Absolutely.
I mean, you know, I mean, like, they wouldn't be there where they were if they were. You know, the leadership was there. How do you try to be a leader today? And what does Cubensis mean to the lay person out there? What does that title mean?
I think that, wait, you're talking literally?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, it's the scientific name for the magic mushroom. So that's the literal meaning of it. Psilocybin cubensis.
Can you explain how, at least from your point of view, how it's affected or changed your musical... the vibe that you bring based on your use of magic mushrooms?
When you experience psychedelics, and you've talked to plenty of folks who have experienced plenty of psychedelics, so this might sound
towards
like
a perception kind of thing, but I'm thinking, like, for you personally, how did it impact your point of view?
Well, as it opens up your mind, it opens up your ears as well. You become able to listen to everything on another level. No longer does sound just wash over you and then pass you by and then it's gone. It's no longer it hits you and you analyze it and you experience it on a bunch of different levels before it leaves. And I think that could probably go across the board between listening to music in an audience in a concert situation, listening to music on your own, on a stereo at home or on headphones, or performing the music live. I feel like it has to be that level of impact in order for it to make sense, and for it to have emotional value.
Yo, one of my boys is Alex Jordan, dude. Give Alex Jordan a shout out.
Alex. Well, I mean,
he was in Cubensis before he joined Midnight North.
He was my sub in Cubensis when I would be out with Bobby, out with Womack. Alex would come in and play the shows, and he had yet to experience a role like that in terms of playing that much.
How did he grow in that role?
So he had come. He had come to see us a few times and got to know us, and had joined the crew, helping us load gear and move stuff around and deal with technical problems.
Absolutely.
And he was a vocal major at Cal State Long Beach.
Wow, this is so unreal.
Musically in tune, in and of, and you know, he had his own thing happening musically, and was a guitar player.
Very
in
driven too. The calling was there.
Very driven. And so, at some point, we said, well, Alex, let's play together sometime. He said, yeah, let's do it for my birthday. So on his birthday, he sat in and played his ass off, and we said this could be a good a good situation moving forward if we want to go there. So,
one final question for you.
Yes, sir.
Can you talk about the calling that you have for music? Did the music choose you? And can you put it into, can you articulate the calling that is vibration in music for you?
There has never been a doubt that my connection to art, to people, to community, to God is via music. And that came directly as a gift from my parents. My father, the music lover and record store owner himself, made it very clear that that was his connection to those things.
He had a record store in Wyoming?
He owned a record store.
What was the name
Wyoming.
Of the store?
It's called Top Notch Records.
Yo, honestly, oh man, I would have loved to have dug through those
used records, that, man.
All right, go ahead. You learned from him.
I don't ever remember him sitting me down and saying, yo, this is the way it is, because that's not how humans learn. We learn not by lecture, but by example and by experience. And to see firsthand how much he cared for the music, it was not lost on me at a young age. And I can't ever forget that, because that's all there is. That is the connection to music.
Nathaniel LaPointe, go play your ass off, man.
Jake,
all right? Much love
for
to you,
man.
See you later, man. Peace.